is dependent on how we as an industry, along with our partners and intermediaries, engage with the customer. Our manner of engagement has been extremely transactional. We are seeing, and I was very, really happy to hear what we heard in the last panel. So we are at the margin making inroads. However, there's a lot more which needs to be done. The crucial issue is, hence, again, comes back to how is our investor going to experience that product? And that's where, again, this whole issue of mandated savings comes in. I mean, I'll give you an example. We did some study. The Chilean system, which is like a developing country, I mean, they started on a mandated savings system. And if you look at it today, and this was way back in the late 90s, today, if you look at it, the amount of money which is there in that system, the Chilean markets are not even able to absorb that. Half of that money is actually invested abroad. So that is one part of it, saying that, yes, there's a large amount of money which can come in. But the second very important thing which it does is it forces or helps us that our customers essentially experience our product and are willing to look at least some part of the product from a long-term basis. Once you get that opportunity to get in and engage in a dialogue with a customer, I think there are lots of other things which you can talk about. I do firmly believe that as a mutual fund product, we should be able to take 20, 30, a meaningful part of a household saving. We do have the right products and there is value to be added. The only thing we have to do is to get the engagement right. Mandated saving thing, something will really, really get us to in front of the customer. He'll be open to talk to us. Because today, let's accept it. I think most investors who really experience our product don't really believe that this product has a role to play in their lives. That's the unfortunate situation.
Right. So what I'm hearing is that good things have happened. Industry has gone through fire, but that has kind of purified the product. And it is a product which the investor will be well served to own, which gets me to the second part of this discussion, which is to say that here is a product. It's a great product. You have 10, 15-year CAGRs of large cap funds now, and it's 22% CAGR. Which other product has done so well? But when you then, we are in a market with several different parts of the market. So there is insurance, there is pension, and NPS. If I look at some numbers, and then we see that the regulations are very different across market segments. The same kind of a product that mutual funds have 100 restrictions on are wildly sold, missold in the insurance industry, for instance. And the banks have very little restrictions. So the draft guidelines on consumer protection are out now after 10 years after they should have actually thought about it. So we've seen laxity in regulation on controlling the kind of product structure and selling communications. So, you know, it kind of, I couldn't wrap my head around why is this industry treated in a particular manner and why is it that insurance and banking, and then you look at some numbers, insurance, life insurance companies hold 5 trillion rupees of central government securities, banks hold more than 10 trillion through the SLR. So these are investment rules, guidelines set in the Insurance Act, the RBI Act, which mandate the investment which goes into central government securities. You look at the deficit numbers, you look at government spending, and you know why one part of the market has leverage. How much does the fund industry have to invest in central government securities? Is there any restriction? Nothing. So my answer finally came, probably it was too late and it's very silly, it took me so many years to figure this out. But finally I understood that you cannot have a level playing field when one part of the market is financing the government deficit. So Nimesh, I mean, is it even a valid argument, what I'm saying?
Actually, wrong question to ask me. Because we are in every phase of the market.
Exactly.
Right? So
no, maybe you wanted to be a, you know, the CEO of an insurance company.
I was presenting to the ICICI Bank board. This was 3 days back. When I was presenting to the ICICI Bank board, I said last 3 years I've been the fastest growing, within the group, I'm the fastest growing business in financial services. If you see, there was merchant, there was investment banking over there, there was insurance company over there, there was bank over there. The mutual fund business of ICICI Group is one of the fastest growing business in the group. if the product is very pure, I'll say only this, which I said in the board meeting also, that if the product is very pure for the final customer, that business will grow. So I'm not actually worried. I'm not actually worried what is the other industry doing or what any industry in the country is doing. At the end of the day, are we doing a very pure job for the final customer? We are doing that. That is showing in the results now. Right? If it's showing in the results, this industry will grow the maximum.
So it doesn't worry you?
It doesn't.
Does it worry you, Ashu, that the rules are different and you are the underdog?
So I'm delighted that we don't have SLR, CRR and all of that, because if you had that, you couldn't have been in the mutual fund business and you can forget about all the conversations you spent the day on. I absolutely believe that if you add value, you will get customers and your business will grow. And we have enough and more evidence to demonstrate that we have added value. You yourself said 22% large cap, and that's one you can find all kinds of risk profiles. The challenge has always been, we're a traditional savings market which has led a life of a lot of uncertainty and deprivation for decades and centuries, right? So that's a mindset which needs comfort in guarantees. And SLR, CRR and the associated industries that have that because they provide those guarantees. We're the only pure play business where risk and reward are directly linked. So it's a journey that we in the financial services space have to go through. And I'm very, very confident with more time on side, the industry will be much larger. And the only reason will be that the value demonstrated to the end investor will be the maximum. And you have enough examples of developing and developed economies. And in the developing spectrum, we're pretty okay, right? We are not the most developed market. We are not even top of the line on the developing. So there is no surprise that you see what you see here. And also as an industry, and you know, every time we get asked this question, you guys have been around for so long and, you know, where have you grown? You know, you look around, it's a two-decade-old industry. You compare to banking with all the benefits, and financial inclusion still needs a prime minister to issue a Jan Dhan Yojana.
Absolutely.
To get that, right?
Absolutely.
We do it within the constraints of no guarantees, no promises, no nothing. So I think it's fantastic.
Dinesh, and would you agree? I mean,
you know,
you're a banker.
That's my main point.
And so is it a valid, is my argument a valid argument?
No, I think what I will, how I will respond is that typically speaking, the preemption is something which is against the free market play. So that actually leads to more of inefficiencies. I will take you to the, in a little different perspective. When you look at any insurance company, they're also investing money. But is anybody evaluating their performance in terms of how are they performing? How are those schemes performing? And eventually, I think any financial institution, unless and until it deploys the resources in the most efficient manner, it cannot survive on a very long-term basis. So I think this is one perspective which I would like to bring in. So
okay, finally, finance 101 will prevail. Yeah. Bala.
I think these two are two different animals, in the sense that I think the...
No, my question is that... How can you compete when you are against somebody who finances the government deficit?
Yeah, that's the point I'm saying. It's, of course, the way the whole structure is created for different type of product offering coming from two different type of entities, it's actually meant that way. That's the way it is. I think when you talked about $5 trillion, it's largely is coming from the largest insurance company in the country. And they are, in any case, they are the market mover, they are the market participants. They are there for certain purposes, which is providing risk cover for the people. Whereas the mutual fund are not mutual funds.
I mean, that company doesn't provide risk cover. It provides
3%
return.
Yeah, whatever, of course, whichever we look at it. But at the end of the day, the mutual fund is something which is, of course, the entire market risk is passed on. And despite that, it's a high level of transparency. And we are where we are going, where we're going. I think the one thing which, of course, could be potentially be something seen as a something is essential from mutual fund industry's point of view, is clearly something which is the one, we are the biggest market makers in whichever we form you look at it. And development of the capital market play an important role, which all the intermediaries do play actually. And some with the restrictions, some do not with the restrictions. And the mutual fund industry do not have that kind of restrictions, open market when they operate. Hence, the risk is completely passed on. And that being the case, I think the comparison itself, if you ask me, it will not be the right argument. And given the fact that both of them are created for the purpose of serving certain needs, and any deviations can never be considered as something.
Nice diplomatic answer, Arshendu. Pure play mutual fund.
So any regulatory arbitrage obviously causes distortion, so that's not great. But I don't think that is the reason why the situation is what it is. I think these two industries, banking and insurance, have been there since independence, and mutual fund is relatively a young industry. It's only got a 20-year track, and I think it's evolving. The one message I see constantly from the government is that they want more money to go towards financial products and capital markets. And all of the regulatory change you've seen in the last few years is encouraging that. So I don't see, therefore, this conflict. I think it's just a question of evolution. And in fact, I find the government encouraging financial literacy, financial inclusion, money movement towards capital markets. And so I think if our product, as you know, everybody is saying, is good, I think this industry will find its place eventually.
Chandresh.
I want to add a point.
Yeah.
And, you know, just taking off from what Harshendu said, the fact is that the government is encouraging more into financial products and capital market products. The fact is the more money that comes into the mutual fund, the better capital formation will be. I mean, it's a given, right? So the government has absolutely no incentive not to let the mutual fund industry grow. The only reason you have that kind of deficit financing in a way, while yes, we have a fiscal deficit, and that's a fact, right? It's not only India, it's many countries.
It is the way it is financed. I mean, India does it through repression. Yeah. Repression is when household savings are appropriated by the government for sub-inflation-linked return. That is financial repression, which is the market that we are in.
Yeah, right. So that's not going to change. Yeah. I mean, you know, we can take that discussion into subsidies, and the answer won't be different. But the point that I want to make is precisely the reason where guarantees are provided. Do you need to do that? Because the government is considered safe. And we haven't had a government default. And, you know, we have an economy that dates back centuries now. So that's something to really take on board so that this point in some ways is rested.
Okay. Chandresh.
Yeah, so I think I would agree with you, I think, upfront that yes, the kind of clout or weight which the mutual fund industry has in the government with the regulators, obviously much less than the other two industries. And I think obviously it's to do with that absolute amount of money which is already in there. And obviously it helps to support the government's borrowing program and all that. But I think, so as we grow bigger, I think, we will also start to see some of that cloud coming with us. Now, the focus is, I think, we're talking about from a regulator's perspective, what he can do. I think from our perspective, what we need to do is to see how we can grow this. And grow this so that we become big and have that cloud. One very interesting...
Their cloud is coming from owning G-Sex. Their cloud comes from owning a part of the government securities.
No, so we probably will never be able to contribute to the borrowing program, or will be in a very small way. But I must tell you that there was this meeting I was part of, let's say late last year, and this was after we had the currency crisis, etc. And the finance ministry was chairing a meeting between the mutual fund, and all the other regulators were there, the RBI governor, the SEBI chief, everybody was there. And the government understands that mutual funds can be a big driver of capital formation, directing savings from non-financial assets to financial assets. The fact that we haven't done it yet is something which makes them feel, oh, nothing is going to happen in a short run in this industry. But that understanding and acceptance is there that, yes, this is something which can become quite big.
So would it help?
I would like to add, eventually the size becomes critical. Unless and until the size is critical, maybe the kind of a favored view about the industry will not be there. I think more than anything else, the industry has to grow in size and it should become relevant for the economy. That is something right. which holds the key.
So to level the playing field, would it help if all financial products were to disclose their rates of return? Because there's one part of the market which gets away by promising all kinds of things on all kinds of things. But if you take out the annual rate of return, it is 3-4%. So would it help, and anyone can like pick up on this, would it help to level the playing field in terms of being able to announce the potential rate of return?
I think
so like for instance, you have insurance policies which are endowment or money back. There's a definite payout. The bonus can get added
then
later.
Then you need capital.
No, that's right. No, I'm saying in terms of disclosure, were they to disclose the rate of return, then it looks really poor. So would that help?
I think it would be really, really beneficial if the insurance guy say that, okay, this is the return I gave the last 20 years. I think it would really be helpful to us, certainly.
That would be good if we were to see that data.
I would put it a little differently. Instead of asking somebody else to change, and I think the point Archanda had made earlier, which is at a time where we used to actually disclose what the return that is coming from the mutual fund industry, right from a liquid fund to the equity funds, there were restrictions which was put, and all of us could also disclose the how the performance have been coming, whether it in any parameter you look at it. If that itself is made available, I think the battle is won. That is one. And second is there are also other restrictions which also came. Increasingly, the money managers are asked to manage money, and somebody is performing. You can continue to manage different type of funds and continuously for different point of times. Not necessarily all the funds which are meant with the different portfolio construction strategy will perform the same way. It will have a deviation in terms of performance. Today.